Good morning, everyone. Welcome to our morning service, whether you are joining us here in the meeting house or in the church hall or by the internet service or watching on DVD. Thank you for joining us for worship today. And we trust that the Lord will bless each one of us wherever we are as together we worship him. The announcements for today and for this week are as follows. The Zoom service will take place this evening at 6:30 p.m. On Tuesday at 2 p.m., the men's fellowship begins again in the Crossley Hall Men's Fellowship on Tuesday at 2 p.m. Former members and, of course, new members will be made most welcome. On Wednesday, we meet for physical in-person prayer meeting at 7:25 p.m. That will actually take place in the Crossley Hall. And then it will be followed at 8 p.m. by the midweek Bible study. So we would encourage you to come to pray, 7:25 Crossley Hall, and also midweek Bible study in the Crossley Hall immediately afterwards. Next Sunday, as far as I know, Sunday school and teen talk will start again at 10:30 a.m. Sunday school and teen talk next Sunday morning. The service here next Sunday morning will be conducted by the Reverend Victor Patterson, as I am conducting the service in Killyleagh Presbyterian Church, and then Zoom service next Sunday evening. If anyone has become a Christian through saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ and is considering becoming a communicant member of the congregation, would you please contact me as soon as possible, and a series of communicant inquiry classes will then be arranged in preparation for the November communion. Likewise, if there's anyone who wishes to transfer their communicant membership from elsewhere to our congregation, again, would you please speak to me so that that can be organized. Now, as you probably many of you noticed on the screen, rolling on the screen prior to the service beginning today, there were various announcements with regard to what the Kirk session has decided going forward from today onwards. But just in case any of you didn't notice those or didn't have an opportunity to see them, let me just kind of quickly run through those. So these decisions were taken by the Kirk session on Tuesday night past. So Bibles and hymn books and cushions to be returned to the pews, and that has already happened, and I'm sure all the bones in your back and backsides are grateful, first of all, for that very practical measure and those things being restored. In the meantime, no printed announcements will be produced. All announcements will appear on the various churches' media platforms and on the screen prior to the service. Therefore, if you want something to appear by any of those means, please send your announcement, your information, through to Andy Clark by Thursday each week. I should maybe just add, if you're not on any of the media platforms and want to be, then speak to Andy or to myself, and that can, of course, be arranged so that you have access to all the information as soon as it is available. 1 meter social distancing will be observed during the church services in the meeting house and in the hall. Our Kirk session decided that face coverings should continue to be worn throughout the services. We feel this is wise in view of the high COVID infection rate in Northern Ireland. The stewards will continue to usher people in and out. Please remember hand sanitizing as you enter and as you leave. Funeral services held here in Carrickduff Presbyterian Meeting House. Attendances at those should not exceed 75 people, and names and telephone numbers should be supplied in advance for the purposes of track and trace. And finally, the evening services, physical, in-person evening services, will start again this night fortnight, Sunday the 26th of September at 6:30 p.m. And therefore, the prayer meeting beforehand will be at 6 p.m. So we hope, of course, that when the evening services are restored, that many of you will avail of that opportunity to come to worship God in evening worship as well as morning. So those were the decisions taken by the Kirk session, you have throughout all of this, as a congregation, all of you have been most cooperative with regard to all of these matters, and I'm sure that that will continue to be the case, and we thank you for your understanding with regard to all of these things. And all of these decisions will, of course, be reviewed as and when necessary at later session meetings. Thank you for patiently listening to all of that. We worship God in Isaiah chapter 2 and verse 3. The prophet says, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths." We've come to the house of the Lord. Let us praise him, and we can stand. It has been decided that by the Kirk session that we can stand to praise God. Keep your masks on, of course, throughout, but we stand to praise God. Come, people of the risen King, who delight to bring him praise. Let us stand.
Thank you.
we bow together in prayer. Let us pray. We do indeed rejoice, O God. We rejoice that on the morning of your day, we are able to gather here. We are able to stand, we're able to sing, and we're able to praise you. As the book of Revelation, chapter 4 and verse 11 reminds us, you are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you have created all things, and for your pleasure they are and were created. So we bow before you in the attitude of worship. We acknowledge you as our Creator and as our Lord, and it is our chief purpose to glorify you, to bring you pleasure, and to enjoy you forever. And yet, Lord, we acknowledge too that we have come short of your glory. We have not loved you with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, nor yet have we always loved our neighbor as ourselves. Therefore, we pray that you would apply again to our needy hearts the blood of the Lamb, that we may be cleansed of all sin. Restore unto us the joy of our salvation, that we may walk in the way of your commandments and delight to do your will. Lord God, in all the twists and turns of life's journey, help us to trust you, knowing that you have a plan and purpose for each of our lives. Help us not, therefore, to fret or fume or to be cumbered with a load of care. Make us to know that you do all things well. What we do not understand, help us to accept, because with acceptance comes peace. Help us, Lord, to know that all things work together for good to those who love you. All things work together for your glory, because you have so ordained it. Therefore, Heavenly Father, it is with glad and willing hearts that we gather here to worship you, and we pray that we may benefit in our souls as we do so. But we pray also that you, O Lord, would take delight and pleasure in the worship of your people. Hear us, Lord God, as we sum up these, our petitions, in those words which Jesus taught his disciples to say, saying together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So, girls and boys, most of you have probably been back to school now for about a week and a half, and I hope all is going well, although I've heard some reports from some parts of the country, even some not very far from here, where classes have had to be stopped again because of children affected with COVID-19 and all of that kind of thing. So, but I hope all of you who have been able to go back to school that you've had a good start and that all goes well for you in the coming days and weeks. Now, there's one or two children actually here in the meeting house. I'm not quite sure if there's any in the hall today or not. Could any of you who's here, could you tell me something that you need, something that your mom and dad has to get for you before you go to school? They certainly have to get this for the first time for you when you start P1. But you also probably have to have it P2, 3, and on up. Emily? What was that? A school uniform. Excellent answer. And that's the answer I was looking for. So I'll stop there. There's lots of other things, of course. School bags, pencils, rubbers, rulers, etc. But a school uniform is what I was thinking of. Before you go to school, whether you're starting P1 or older, you've got to get a school uniform. And I have some examples with me here today. So, here we have a sweatshirt from Academy Primary School in Saintfield. Okay, anybody own this sweatshirt here? James, at the very front here, James Shannon, that's right. So here we have the school, the sweatshirt belonging to Saintfield Academy Primary School. Okay, would I fit into this, James? No? I think I nearly would, you know. I'm quite small. Okay, so here we are. There's one there, okay, from Academy Primary School in Saintfield. Here we have Cairns Hill. Cairns Hill Primary School. A sweatshirt from Cairns Hill Primary School. I think this belongs to Daniel. Well, I don't think I know. This belongs to Daniel Kajugu, and Daniel is in the hall. So thank you, Daniel, for, as equally thank you, James, for lending me yours. And this is Daniel Kajugu's Cairns Hill Primary School. Okay. And here we have another one. Carr Primary School. And this belongs to Rebecca Dorman, who attends Carr Primary School. So thank you to Rebecca, or it might be Rachel's, I'm not sure. Thank you for the lend of that. And then we have Carriduff Primary School. Anybody in the congregation here today, does this belong to anyone? Aaron. That's right, Aaron Douglas down there in the back pew. Thank you, Aaron. I would definitely fit into that one, wouldn't I? Thank you, Aaron. So that's Carriduff Primary School. Now, why do you think you need to wear a uniform going to school? Why can't you just go wearing whatever you like? Any suggestions as to why you need to wear a uniform when you go to school? Any ideas? Any suggestions? Aaron? Shout that out a bit louder for me. I need to get the wax out of my ears. So that the teachers, Mom, you shout it out. That's a good answer. Absolutely. So that everyone knows, well, that boy, James Shannon, he belongs to Academy Primary School in Saintfield, or Daniel belongs to Cairns Hill Primary, or Rebecca belongs to Carr, or Aaron belongs to Carriduff. It shows what school you belong to. That's right. It shows what school you belong to. And you should be proud of the school that you go to, whatever school you go to. And I suppose if you're out at a school outing, for example, elsewhere, it's easier for the teachers to kind of spot where all their pupils are by the school uniform. And I suppose another thing is it saves boys and girls competing with each other as to what to wear. Maybe, you know, if you could just wear whatever you like, one person would come in with this and somebody else would come in with that, and you might start to show off what you'd got. So, but everybody wears the same thing, then there's no dispute, there's no competition, there's no arguing about it. So the uniform shows what school you belong to. And boys and girls, strange though it sounds, the Bible says that there's a kind of a uniform that we need to wear. There's a kind of a uniform as Christians that we need to wear. Because it tells us this in Romans chapter 13 and verse 14. It tells us this. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Just as you get up in the morning and you put on your school uniform, so the Bible says, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. That actually means simply trust in him. Give your life to him. Make sure that your faith is in him. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ. It's something you've got to do. Just as you put on your uniform, put on the Lord Jesus Christ. Make sure that you're trusting in him. And then after you've done that, by the life that you live, you're supposed to show that you belong to the Lord Jesus Christ. Because we're told in Colossians 3, verses 12 and 14, we're told this. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. So, put on the Lord Jesus, trust in him. And then, having done that, put on all these things. These are the things that show that you belong to Jesus. Just as these uniforms show that you belong to the school that you go to. So these are the things that should show others that we belong to Jesus, the uniform of a Christian. So boys and girls, and mums and dads, and everyone, I hope you have already put on the Lord Jesus, that you're trusting in him. And may God help us each one day by day to put on these other things, the uniform of the Christian believer, to show that we belong to him. So let's say this text, these words that are on the screen just now, after 2:1-2. Therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Colossians chapter 3, verses 12 and 14. So, now we're going to sing the children's hymn. And it's Blessed Be the Name of the Lord. Standing to sing. Thank you. It is with regret that we intimate the death of Mr. Billy Giles, who passed away last Sunday and whose funeral took place on Thursday. We express our sincere sympathy to his family circle, and we commend them to the comfort of Almighty God. We remember them and all who mourn at the present time in our prayers of intercession. Amanda is going to lead us in our prayers of intercession today, and after that she will also do the Bible reading. The Bible reading will be from Mark chapter 8, verses 11 to 21. As you know, in the morning services we've returned to the series on Mark's Gospel. But first of all, our prayers of intercession by Amanda.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of being able to speak to you directly through prayer. Lord, we thank you for your love and compassion and for all of our provisions. Lord, we pray for Christians throughout the world who are being persecuted at this time because of their faith in you. Lord, we ask for your protection for them and strength and guidance for those who will help them. Lord, we pray for our church here in Carrickduff. May your people here be built up in their faith as they live out their lives day by day. To those, Lord, who find it hard to follow you, give them courage. To those who are weak, give them strength. We pray for all our leaders and organizations within the church as they prepare for a new season of work. May they be refreshed and ready to serve you, Lord, with a passion in their hearts to convey your love with your people. We pray too, Lord, for our children and our young people as they attend school and for their teachers. Lord, in these uncertain days where COVID-19 is so prominent, we ask for protection in our schools. We think of all those who are afflicted by this virus and are suffering from the short and long-term effects of COVID-19. Lord, please bring healing and comfort and slow the spread of the virus. We thank you too, Lord, for all of our doctors and nurses within hospitals and other practices, as well as those who care and help for patients and their families. Lord, we pray too for those who have lost the fight of COVID-19 and those that have lost loved ones. And Lord, we ask for your continuing love to surround them at this time. We pray likewise for those we know and love at this time who are suffering through ill health. And we ask that you will touch them with your healing hands and bring them back to full health and strength. We pray for the family of Billy Giles at this sad time. Lord, we pray that you will give them the comfort and reassurance to know that you're with them. We pray too for others that are known to the congregation that have also lost loved ones over the recent days. And we pray that you'll give them comfort in the days ahead to all their families. Lord, we pray too for all of those who are starting school for the first time and those who are starting uni for the first time as well. Lord, that you, maybe some that are leaving home for the very first time, be with them as they take these first steps and help them to start their new lives with calmness and confidence. May they make new friends and find encouragement and help in these new situations. We pray too for our government and leaders as you command us to. Lord, we pray that you'll give them wisdom to govern with a better sense of justice and love. Help them to lead with integrity and sincerity. Lord, be with those who also dedicate their work to you, along with the homeless people and the needy. Lord, the numbers of homeless people have risen in our streets, and we pray that you'll give them protection and look after them. Lord, for those that do work amongst them, we thank you for their dedication and their willingness to serve you. Lord, we just pray now that you'll be with us through the rest of the service and to Mr. Smith as he preaches your word. Lord, we thank you that you listen to our prayers, and we pray these all in your name. Amen. So the Bible reading today is found in Mark chapter 8, and it's verses 11 to 21. Let us hear the word of God. The Pharisees came and began to question Jesus. To test him, they asked him for a sign from heaven. He sighed deeply and said, "Why does this generation ask for a miraculous sign? I tell you the truth, no sign will be given to it." Then he left them, got back into the boat, and crossed to the other side. The disciples had forgotten to bring bread, except for one loaf they had with them in the boat. "Be careful," Jesus warned them. "Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod." They discussed this with one another and said, "It is because we have no bread." Aware of their discussion, Jesus asked them, "Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not see or understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? And don't you remember, when I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up?" 12, they replied. "And when I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up?" They answered, 7. He said to them, "Do you still not understand?" And may God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Amen.
Thank you very much indeed, Amanda. There are those who say the plumber's wife is the last to get her dripping tap fixed. The electrician's wife is the last to get the faulty switch in the kitchen fixed. The painter and decorator's wife is the last to get her sitting room done up. Possibly even the minister's wife is the last to get sympathetic pastoral attention from the minister. So sometimes those at the very center of things, can feel overlooked, or indeed they can overlook the obvious themselves. In Mark chapter 6, the disciples had witnessed Jesus feeding 5,000 people. And in fact, they had helped him. They had helped him to distribute the bread and the fish. And in Mark chapter 8, the disciples witnessed Jesus feeding 4,000 people. And again, they had assisted him in distributing the bread and fish. Now, these very same disciples seem somewhat concerned about the fact that they have only one loaf with them. Sounds slightly bizarre when you think about it. If he had fed 5,000, if he had fed 4,000, if necessary, he could surely also feed 12 of them. But as ever, Jesus used the situation as a teaching opportunity. And since, therefore, they were concentrating on bread, he uses that to teach these disciples some valuable lessons. So, first of all, he cautions them. Verse 15, "Be careful," Jesus warned them. "Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees and that of Herod." Now, in the Bible, yeast or leaven is a symbol of corruption, a symbol of false teaching that slips in and permeates and pollutes the gospel. And we learn from this passage and also from the parallel passage, because there is a parallel passage to this in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 16, we learn here both from Mark 8 and Matthew 16 that Jesus here warns of corruption in 3 ways. He says, "Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees. Now, the yeast of the Pharisees was legalism. Beware of the yeast of legalism. That is, trying to live the Christian life simply by obeying a set of rules. Fooling yourself into the opinion that if you cross all the right T's and dot all the right I's, you'll get there. Viewing Christianity as a kind of a ladder that you climb up into the presence of God. Now, that is legalism. Because, of course, by ourselves, we cannot climb up into the presence of God. God does not meet us at the top of a ladder. He meets us rather at the foot of the cross. God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself. Christianity is not merely being inhibited, supposedly inhibited by rules. It is rather being inhabited by a ruler. Legalists think they can work their way up into God's presence. Legalists think that salvation is DIY. Do it yourself. But of course, neither you nor I nor anyone, we cannot do it ourselves. It's not a matter of climbing up by our efforts, but rather God comes down to where we are and meets us at the foot of the cross. May the Lord have mercy on the legalistic church. It has no joy, no thrill, no excitement because it thinks it has to work its way up instead of accepting the Christ who has come down. We also learn then from the parallel account in Matthew chapter 16, there's a little additional bit that isn't here in Mark, but in Matthew chapter 16, Jesus also says this. He says, "Be on your guard against the yeast of the Sadducees." Now, the yeast of the Sadducees, you might say, was the yeast of liberalism. Liberalism. The Sadducees didn't believe in the supernatural. They didn't believe in the power of God. For example, they had no concept in their thinking about the resurrection. They dismissed that completely. I once heard one of my elders saying they didn't believe in the resurrection. That is why they were sad, you see. There's a little memory aid for you. They were sad, you see, because they didn't believe in the resurrection. Well, in fact, they didn't believe in anything supernatural. They didn't believe in the power of God. They didn't believe that God could do miracles. And of course, when we think about it, the Sadducees are still very much with us to this day, sometimes even embedded within the structures of the church. When I was a student for the ministry, there was at that time a man, some of you of a certain vintage will remember his name, a cleric in the Church of England. He was Bishop of Durham. His name was the Reverend Dr. David Jenkins. Some of you probably remember him from yesteryear. And David Jenkins was a classic liberal. He dismissed the whole idea of the virgin birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. He dismissed the whole idea of the bodily resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. He basically dismissed anything and everything that was miraculous, as it were, supernatural in the Bible. And of course, these kinds of liberal ideas were popular, and they are still popular. To some extent, they have seeped from theological colleges. They have seeped down into ordinary Christians' thinking. And sometimes, therefore, people attempt to explain away all the miracles in rational terms. They say, for example, some liberals say Jesus didn't really walk on the water. He was only a few feet out from the shore, they suggest, and he was really walking on the sand which was a few inches underneath the water, that he just appeared He just appeared as if he was walking in the water, but he was really walking on the sand and the shingle just underneath the water. That's what some of them suggest. Now, of course, that particular theory falls flat on its face, because when Peter tried to walk on the self-same water, he began to sink. Liberals also say, for example, that Jesus didn't really feed the 5,000. He didn't really feed the 5,000. He just asked the little boy to share his 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish, and everyone else then thought that this was a lovely idea, and everyone else got out their lunches and fed each other, and hey, presto, the 5,000 were fed. And on went these kinds of explanations, these rational explanations. And in a sense, God was shorn of his power and his might and his majesty. Man supposedly cut God down to size. Jesus became more of a chum and a mate than the Lord. God became the almighty rather than the almighty. Man supposedly had made God in man's image instead of the other way round. But friends, remember this. Remember, a powerless God will not be able to save you. He will not be able to save you from your sin. A powerless God will be able to do nothing for you in the hour of death. A powerless God will be able to do nothing for you on the day of judgment. So be on your guard against the yeast of the Sadducees. May the Lord help the liberal church that does not know his mighty, miraculous power. And then, of course, Jesus here then mentions something else. He says, watch out for the yeast of Herod. Now, Herod was a godless, secularist, materialistic, worldly king. And so Jesus here says to his disciples, watch out for the yeast of Herod. So the yeast of Herod represents materialism and worldliness. It represents the church that has no dedication. It is the church that has no separated living. It is the church where there is no observable difference between the lifestyle of its members and those of the lost world. In the world in which we live today, it therefore takes a miracle for a man not, or a woman not, to be a materialist. Therefore, those of us who love the Lord Jesus, we must beware of this particular danger. I suspect we are more likely to slip into the yeast of materialism and worldliness. We're more likely to slip into that than we are into legalism or liberalism. That is a greater threat for most of us, I suspect. C.H. Spurgeon once said, I am never afraid for my brethren who have many troubles, but I often tremble for those whose career is prosperous. I am never afraid for my brethren who have many troubles, but I often tremble for those whose career is prosperous. It's an insidious danger that we just become worldly, even those of us who are professing Christians. David in the Old Testament, for example, did not make his major blunder when he was a mere boy tending his father's sheep on the hillside of Bethlehem. He didn't make his major blunder when he faced the giant Goliath. He did not make his major blunder when he was a fugitive being hunted by King Saul. Rather, he made his major blunder when he was king, when in a sense he had made it, when all was materially going well for him, and he had time to loll about in the rooftop, he had time to look around him, and he looked lustfully on Bathsheba and desired her for himself, and went to endless evil limits to obtain her as his own. That's when he yielded to temptation. So, surely you and I should learn the lesson well. Watch out for the yeast of the Pharisees, legalism. Watch out for the yeast of the Sadducees, liberalism. And watch out for the yeast of the Herodians, materialism. In 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 7 and 8, Paul writes this: get rid of the old yeast, that you may be a new batch without yeast, as you really are. For Christ our Passover lamb has been sacrificed. Therefore let us keep the festival, not with the old yeast, the yeast of malice and wickedness, but with bread without yeast, the bread of sincerity and truth. So he cautions them, beware of false teaching that is dangerous and corrupts, a lesson that all of us to this day need to take on board. He cautions them. But then secondly, he questions them. He questions them. Whenever Jesus spoke of the yeast of the Pharisees and Sadducees and Herodians, it would appear that the disciples mentally, as it were, went off on a kind of a tangent and began to discuss their lack of bread. They discussed this with one another and said, it's because we have no bread. That's why he's talking about this yeast business. But Jesus, in rapid-fire succession, drilled his disciples with a whole series of questions. Why are you talking about having no bread? Do you still not understand? Are your hearts hardened? Do you have eyes but fail to see, and ears but fail to hear? I suspect that when Jesus was finished firing those questions at the disciples, all you could hear was the noise of the oars being dipped in the water. But the disciples got the message. Jesus was challenging them. Jesus was seeking to arouse them from their spiritual lethargy. And so he says to them, he asks them another question, don't you remember? When I broke the 5 loaves for the 5,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? 12, they replied. And when I broke the 7 loaves for the 4,000, how many basketfuls of pieces did you pick up? They answered, 7. He said to them, do you still not understand? Do you still not understand? You see, he was asking them to remember. To remember what he had done for those vast crowds and what he had done for them. And whenever you and I feel ourselves, as it were, in the spiritual doldrums, when we feel ourselves spiritually dry and arid, we need to take ourselves in hand. We need to take ourselves, as it were, by the scruff of the neck and actively remember God's goodness to us and what God has done for us in the past. Time and again, the people of Israel, for example, were told to remember what God had done for them. And they had to be told this over and over and over again. Remember the Lord your God who brought you up out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Remember the Lord your God who led you those 40 years through the wilderness, Deuteronomy 8 and verse 2. Remember the days of old. Consider the generations long past. Ask your father and he will tell you, your elders, and they will explain to you. Deuteronomy 32 verse 7. And here Jesus was quite simply saying to these disciples who had forgotten so soon apparently or had failed to see the significance of what had happened so recently, he simply says to them, remember. Remember the feeding of the 5,000. Remember the feeding of the 4,000. So what are you getting yourself all het up about that you only have 1 loaf? Have you forgotten? Why worry? I am here. I am in the boat with you. And surely he was asking them not only to remember his power in the feeding of the 5,000 and the feeding of the 4,000, but to remember his person, who he was, and his presence with them. They were to remember what was later written in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, where the Apostle Paul says, remember Jesus Christ, raised from the dead, descended from David. So I wonder, my friend, have you done that? The disciples were guilty of getting so obsessed with physical bread that they had only one loaf. They were guilty of getting so obsessed with that they were forgetting who was with them, that the one who had fed the 5,000 and the 4,000 was with them. And he, of course, was the bread of life. And doubtless this is one of the reasons why Jesus instituted the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, isn't it? He knew how fickle and forgetful, even the best of believers, how frail we are spiritually, how fickle we are, how forgetful we can be, even the best of believers. And so he instituted the Lord's Supper and said, do this, by the way, do this in remembrance of me. We need to be reminded, because, hey, we're apt to forget. So maybe there's a believer here today, a genuine believer here today, and you need to, in a sense, question yourself about forgetting about Jesus. Strange, sounds strange, isn't it? But we could be so caught up just in the humdrum of life and living and everyday things that you almost forget about Jesus, who he was, what he did, what he went through for you. Lest I forget Gethsemane, lest I forget thine agony, lest I forget thy love for me, lead me to Calvary. Look again at his crowned brow, at his nail-pierced hands and side, the sweat and the spittle. Meditate again on all that he went through. Or maybe there's someone else here today, and in fact, you have never, not even for the first time, you have never come to Christ. He has never got inside your heart and life. You're like someone who looks at a loaf and you admire it. And you say to yourself, I'm sure that loaf would do me good. But it never gets out of the wrapper and it never actually gets into you. So admiring the loaf will do you absolutely no good. It needs to get into you. And thinking that Jesus was, not just thinking, but knowing that Jesus was the Son of God and that he died for sinners like you, that will do you no good unless you trust him yourself, unless you put on the Lord Jesus, unless you invite him in and he becomes part of your very life. He says, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will never go hungry. He who believes in me will never be thirsty. Him that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out. Come today, while you may. There's a welcome in the mat for you. There's a place in the Father's house of many mansions for you, if you will but come to him. Let's pray. Gracious God and Heavenly Father, just as your Son, the Lord Jesus, cautioned those disciples so long ago, so we today need to hear that same caution. We need to be beware of the yeast of the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the Herodians. Beware of legalism and liberalism and materialism. Lord, help us to take these warnings on board and to have our spiritual antennae ever alert to discern the truth from error and good from bad. And Heavenly Father, we thank you that Jesus questioned those disciples so long ago, seeking to stimulate their spiritual memory and to stimulate their spiritual lives. And Heavenly Father, that same Jesus would question us today. He would question us about whether or not we are remembering him and focusing upon him in the way that we ought to be. So help us, Lord, not to forget him. Help us not to forget what he went through and all that he did for the likes of us. And Lord, should there be anyone in this congregation today, or listening at home today, should there be someone, Lord, who has heard of Jesus but never heeded his call, we pray that this would be the day, Lord, that they partake of Christ, the bread of life, that they would be saved, and that then they would be nourished, and that they would then be equipped, O God, to walk with Christ and to serve him in the days to come. Take your word, bless it to our hearts, please, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Our closing praise is hymn number 89, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, Pilgrim Through This Barren Land. He is the bread of heaven upon whom we need to feed. Standing to sing. The blessing of the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest upon us and abide with us this day and forevermore. And the people of God said, Amen.